داعي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن سيدنا وحبيبنا وقائدنا ومعلمنا محمدًا عبد الله ورسوله صلى الله تعالى عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. أما بعد، all praises due to Allah. We seek His guidance, His mercy, His forgiveness, His assistance. We seek refuge in Allah from the evil within ourselves and from the evil of our actions. Whomsoever Allah guides, there is no one to lead astray, and whomsoever Allah leads astray, there is no one to guide him. I bear witness there is no one worthy of worship except Allah. I bear witness that Muhammad is His servant and His messenger. May the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, upon his family, his companions, and all those who follow them until the last day. O you who believe, revere Allah as you should be revered, and do not die except in a state of surrender. Beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, over the past couple of khutbahs, I have been speaking of a challenging topic related to addressing and understanding domestic violence. However, because of the occasion of having our young with us today, I want to be able to address a message to them before they end up beginning school, and then we will continue, inshallah, the series on domestic violence in the fall, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Qur'an, in the story of Adam, alayhi salatu wa salam, وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً قَالُوا أَتَجْعَلُ فِيهَا مَنْ يُفْسِدُ فِيهَا وَيَسْفِكُ الدِّمَاءِ وَنَحْنُ نُسَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِكَ وَنُقَدِّسُ لَكَ قَالَ إِنِّي أَعْلَمُ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and when your Lord said to the angels, I am placing upon the earth a khalifa, a representative, a successor. The angels, they said, will you place on the earth one who will work corruption therein and will shed blood while we sing your praises and we call you holy? And so Allah responded to them. He said, truly I know what you know not. In another verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَهُوَ الَّذِي جَعَلَكُمْ خَلَائِفَ الْأَرْضِ وَرَفَى بَعْضَكُمْ فَوْقَ بَعْضٍ دَرَجَاتٍ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ فِي مَا آتَاكُمْ إِنَّ رَبَّكَ سَرِيعُ الْعِقَابِ وَإِنَّهُ لَغَفُورُ رَحِيمٌ. That it is He who has made you representatives, successors, khulafa, on the earth, and He has raised some of you by degrees above others, that He may test you with what He has given to you. Truly your Lord is swift in retribution, and truly He is forgiving and merciful. When we look at these two verses, and we understand the role of the human being here on earth as being a khalifa, what exactly does that mean? The idea of khalifa in these verses, it means universal human inheritance and responsibility. This is something that we got from Adam alayhi salam. From the very first human being, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed him on this earth for a reason. That he is a representative of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on this earth. In the sense that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us a trust. He has asked us to do certain things on this earth, and we need to fulfill that trust. We have a sense of responsibility. We have a responsibility to be able to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala while at the same time we spread good. That we do good for those who are within our community and for those who, for ourselves. And so this idea of khilafah, of being a representative, that is in Adam alayhi salam. We know that Adam, of course, being the first human being, he represents all of us as a whole. And so when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed Adam on this earth as a representative of Allah, as a khalifa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it means that all human beings can be understood in this life to be the representatives of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on this earth. Now what is the role then of this representative? Allah tells us in the Quran, وَاذْكُرُوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ وَمِثَاقَهُ الَّذِي وَاثَقَكُمْ بِهِ إِذْ قُلْتُمْ سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلِيمٌ بِذَاتِ الصُّدُورِ. And remember the blessing of Allah upon you and by His covenant, that agreement by which He bound you. So we have a mithaq, we have a covenant. This is like a contract that we have between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah has given us many blessings. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted us or given us guidance. What's our responsibility when we have those blessings and when we have the guidance is that we act upon it. And so then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues in this verse that He's telling us, reminding us, remember the blessing of Allah upon you and remember that contract, that mithaq, that covenant by which He bound you by. And when you said, سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. Now this should be the response of the human being. That when we understand this responsibility, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, here's the guidance, here are the blessings. What's your responsibility? We hear, we obey. That's what our response should be. That it's a responsibility and that the response should be, we hear and obey. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَاتَّقُوا. Have fear, have taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah indeed knows that which is in the heart. And so when we understand this, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us this responsibility by the blessings, by the guidance, if we fulfill that, and this is what our role is, that as human beings we need to fulfill that role, and we'll talk a little bit more about this in a moment, but what's the result? What do we get out of it? If we fulfill this covenant, and we fulfill our responsibilities, and this trust that Allah has given to us, and we become those representatives of Allah on the earth, what's the result? What do we get out of it? Allah tells us, وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ لَيَسْتَخْلِفَنَّهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ كَمَا اسْتَخْلَفَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ وَلَيُمَكِّنَنَّ لَهُمْ دِينَهُمُ الَّذِي ارْتَضَى لَهُمْ وَلِيُبَدِّلَنَّهُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ خَوْفِهِمْ أَمْنًا يَعْبُدُونَنِي لَا يُشْرِكُونَ بِي شَيْئًا وَمَنْ كَفَرَ بَعْدَ ذَلِكَ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْفَاسِقُونَ. Allah has promised those among you who believe and perform righteous deeds. Again, this is our responsibility. We believe in Allah and we do good works. We perform righteous deeds. Allah has promised those people who believe and do righteous deeds that He will make you khulafa, successors on this earth. He'll make you representatives on this earth. He'll establish for them their deen. So you want your deen to be established, you have to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He will establish for them their deen, not only within yourself, but within the earth. That our faith will be established when we fulfill this covenant. And then, which He has approved for them. And then He will change their state from a state of khawf into a state of amn, from a state of fear into a state of security. All of these are results of what? Of fulfilling that covenant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we believe in Allah and we do righteous deeds. Both of them, they come together. That's what makes us representatives of Allah on this earth. If we leave that, then we no longer have these promises that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned in these verses. There's no guarantee, there's no promise that He will establish us on the earth, that He will establish the deen on the earth, that He will change our state of fear into a state of security. They don't apply. Why? Because we're not establishing the deen of Allah ourselves within our lives. We're not fulfilling our role as a khalifa that we should on this earth, representatives of Allah. And so when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then continues, وَأَقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَآتُوا الزَّكَاةَ وَأَطِيعُوا الرَّسُولَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. And establish prayer, give zakat, and obey the messenger so that you will be able to attain the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, some of the commentators on this verse, the ones that were just recited, they said that this was revealed about the Sahaba, who they were living through many years of difficulty and hardship and conflict and persecution. We know that the Sahaba at the beginning of Islam, they had a very difficult time, especially those first 13 years in Mecca. They went through so many hardships and difficulties because of their faith and because of them trying to establish the practice of their faith in their lives. But they were persecuted and there were many conflicts. And then even when they went to Al-Madinah, that there were continuous also, that there were expeditions that the Sahaba would go out for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in order to establish the faith. And so then the Sahaba, they asked that when would come a time when we could put our swords away and live in a state of peace? When would come a time in which we could live without fear? And so then it was this verse that was revealed, that when they have these concerns, that we want a time in which we can live in peace and security, we no longer have to fight with the sword. It was then that this verse was revealed, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised them that. According to other scholars, this verse refers to the first four periods of the Khilafah, the first four Khulafa, the first four caliphs, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, and Umar radiallahu anhu, and Sayyidina Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu, and Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, ajma'in. And so other scholars, they interpret it to mean all of the believers, not just during the first four Khalifas, where some interpreters, they say that this actually refers to all of the believers from that point onwards and the subsequent spread of Islam throughout the lands. And that they were the ones who ended up becoming these inheritors of the earth, successors and representatives or deputies of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, just as those who came before us were representatives of Allah on the earth. So now we have to look at our specific condition. We live here, we're in a state of security. We're in a state of freedom. We can worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have the capacity to be able to practice our faith. And we live in a state of relative security. We don't live in a state of constant fear. Yes, we have incidences that happen within our society that, you know, Islamophobia exists, and there are some incidences in which, you know, people that come against Muslims. But in general, the general state of being that we have here is that we have a general sense of security. We don't have to worry about bombs being dropped over our heads, or some army, some soldiers that are going to come in and kick down our doors and then take us and then beat us and then perhaps kill us and, you know, steal our property and harm our family and whatnot. So we live in a state of relative security here in Canada. And so it's up to us, all of us, collectively, in order to be able to uphold our faith, and especially the new generations that are here in Canada. Those of you who were born and raised here in Canada, those generations that are born here and that are raised here, first generation or second generation Canadians, it is our responsibility, and this is for our youth especially. Uphold your faith. Practice your deen. Hold firmly to Islam and the practice of Islam. And in a manner that will allow others to be able to see how we can actually contribute to our society. Show people the goodness that we have within our faith. And so that this will be a means by which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant us security. He will allow us to be successors in these lands and as representatives of living the deen of Allah on the earth. This is not something that we just want to talk about. This is something that we actually want to put into practice. This is something that we can actually live. And so this is the whole point, is that we need to work to establish ourselves within the community in order to be able to spread the goodness of Islam. What is our role? What's our place here in Canadian society? What is it that we're here to do? When we consider our place here as Canadians or in Canadian society, we have the responsibility to be good, uphold good character, to be able to strive to benefit the people within the society, to be able to be the best Muslim that you can be. Even when you're at school, right? You guys are going to school next week. When you're at school, you have to show your practice as a Muslim, which means you have good character. You don't lie, you don't cheat, you don't steal, you don't bully, right? That's your responsibility as a Muslim. And you can be that representative of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth as a Muslim, and that other people will be able to see this is what Islam is all about. How do they know what Islam is all about? It's through your actions. If you make a mistake or if you fall short, then that's based on the Muslims. That's the human shortcoming that we have, and we're all human. But when it comes to our faith, to Islam, our faith is what is perfect. And so when we implement our faith, when we apply our faith in our surroundings, and people will be able to see that, this is one of the greatest forms of da'wah, of being able to show people and to invite them to this beautiful and peaceful message of our faith. And so that is our role here in Canadian society. Live your faith. We're here to stay. We're not going to go anywhere. Muslims have been in Canada for over the past 120 years. We've been in Canada for even longer than that. And we are here to stay. We're not going anywhere. And we're an integral part of Canadian society. We have to understand that. That we don't have this understanding that we are separate from Canadian society. No, we're a part of the Canadian society. But we don't have to give up our faith in order to do that. We don't have to compromise ourselves. We don't have to give up our principles as Muslims in order to be a part of this society. And so then we have to fulfill our trust. We have to work towards the betterment of the society that we live in, to strive to serve people and to be a source of goodness. And this is what our faith teaches us. This is how we become integrated into our society. Not by changing our beliefs, not by compromising our principles, not by changing our practices, but rather by living by them, whereby others can see the benefits and the blessings that we have, that have been given to us through our faith. Through Islam. There's a hadith of the Prophet that is related from Anas radiallahu anhu, in which the Prophet Anas radiallahu anhu, he said, ما خطبنا نبي الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إلا قال لا إيمان لمن لا أمانة له ولا دين لمن لا عهد له. That Anas radiallahu anhu, he said, the Prophet he did not give a khutbah except that he would say these words. So in other words, it's not one time the Prophet said this. He would always be saying this statement that you don't have complete faith. La iman. You don't have complete faith if you don't have a sense of trust. If people can't trust you, right? That if you have no trust, then your faith is incomplete. You have to be a people, we have to be a people of amana. That people can trust us. That we're not going to be a people of khiyana, of betrayal. That we're straight. And we're a people of trust. And so then the Prophet said, whoever has no trust, they don't have complete faith. And that whoever doesn't fulfill or hold on to this covenant, that you don't have this ahd, then you don't have a deen. You don't have a religion. Because this is our religion. Our religion is about this agreement, this covenant that we have before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in order for us to fulfill. And so that's our role. We can work with other groups. Whether they're Muslim or non-Muslim, right? Whether they're faith-based or not faith-based, right? We can do things on a regular basis. We can have, you know, arrange for soup kitchens, or we can arrange to give charity to the poor, or to be able to help collect things, to be able to work, to establish, connections with other organizations that are doing good. This is part of who we are. There's no problem with that. We can build bridges as a means of mutual respect, as a means of educating others about who we are, about Islam and about Muslims, through our actions. But we can focus also at the same time on developing ourselves. In our homes, we have to also focus on being able to develop ourselves. In other words, that we build our families within our homes. We teach our children the deen. We bring them to the masajid in order so that they can learn their deen and the proper etiquettes of the deen. So it's not only about knowledge, but it's about practice. It's about putting things into implementation. And so that this is the way that in which we can, it's a community effort. And every single one of you has a role. Young or old, believing man, believing woman, believing boy, believing girl, every single one of us has a role. And so that's what the question is that you need to ask yourself is, what is my specific role? What is it that I can do? And if you're able to just simply live your faith and to practice your deen in whatever environment that you're in, then inshallah that's sufficient. We can contribute and we can do more, but do something. Contribute to the society that you live in. We can work simultaneously to spread the message of Islam and the goodness of Islam Even if we find ourselves in difficult situations. We might find ourselves that we're going through some difficulties or trials or hardships in our life. And that's just the nature of the world that we live in. But despite the difficulties and the hardships and the tribulations, we still can work, do righteous deeds to be able to spread the goodness of our faith. We are the ones who are going to build the story for our community. We are the ones who we have to see what part of the grand picture that we play. Because there are all these different pieces of this picture. And so what part of that picture are you? What role do you play in particular? Because we're all pieces of this greater picture. Of what? Of Islam. In Canada. In London. In Ontario. Right? We're all part of this picture. And so we need to build this story and build this picture for ourselves. And to find out where it is that we fit in this particular picture, in this role that we play. What's our specific role? And we can all contribute, even if it's something that is simple. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to benefit us. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us a means to bring good to the people who are around us. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us firm in our faith, young and old. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ الْعَظِيمَ لِي وَلَكُمْ جَمِيعًا وَالْمُسْلِمِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنِينَ فَاسْتَغْفِرُوهُ إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. الحمد لله رب العالمين أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على سيدنا النبي سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. I'll conclude with a hadith of the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم that is related in the collection of Imam al-Tirmidhi and Imam Ahmad, and this is a sahih hadith that Anas رضي الله عنه he narrated, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا أراد الله بعبد خيرا استعمله. قالوا وكيف يستعمله؟ قال يوفقه لعمل صالح قبل موته. يوفقه لعمل صالح قبل موته. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, if Allah wills, desires good for somebody, then he uses him. يستعمله. He employs him. So the Sahaba, they asked the Prophet, how does Allah use you? How does Allah employ you? And so then the Prophet ﷺ, he said, he directs him to perform good deeds right before he dies. In other words, you're in a continuous state of doing good deeds, and you continue doing good deeds all the way up until the point that you die. Because if you die while you're doing good deeds, that's what you're raised up on before on the Day of Judgment, before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so the message behind this hadith, we want to be used by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We want to be those people who Allah employs, who uses the people in order to be able to spread the goodness. How? By doing righteous deeds. And we continue doing that right up until the last moment that we're alive. That's a sign that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us much good. That if He desires for your good, He uses you by doing good deeds so that you do good deeds all the way up until your death. And that is the means by which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will use us. And so we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He use us, that He employs us as being this means of good for people around us so that people can see, and that we do this until the day that we die. That we continue doing this until the day that we meet our Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that we will be resurrected with these good deeds. And the last thing that we do is that's what we're going to be raised up on. Right, يُبَعْثُ عَبْدًا عَلَى مَا مَاتَ عَلَى. Right, that this is what the Prophet ﷺ said, that a person will be resurrected based on whatever he died on. So if you're doing something good and you die doing that something good, that's what you're going to be raised up on before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّ اللَّهُ مَلَائِكَتَهُ يُصَلُّونَ عَلَى نَبِيِّهِ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا صَلَّى عَلَيْهِ وَسَلِّمَ تَسْلِيمًا. اللَّهُمَّ صَلِّ عَلَى مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَى آلِ مُحَمَّدٍ كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات المسلمين والمسلمات الأحياء منهم الأموات إنك يا ربنا سميع قريب مجيب الدعوات. ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين. اللهم ارحم موتانا وموت المسلمين واشف مرضانا ومرضى المسلمين. اللهم انصر إخواننا المستضعفين المظلومين في كل مكان. انصرهم في مشارق الأرض وفي مغاربها يا رب العالمين. والطف بنا وبجميع المسلمين بلطفك فيما جرت به المقادير. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. والحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.